Oh, I'm ready if you're ready. You are all my very favorite people because you withstood the temptation to just sit down at the beach with a cold bottle of beer. Thank you for coming back in. All right, let's see. So, I'm Axel. I'm the Managing Director of the RIPE NCC. What is the RIPE NCC? It's your secretariat. You're part of the RIPE community. The NCC, the RIPE Network Coordination Center, acts as the secretariat for the RIPE community. Not only do we arrange for meetings for the community to come along to facilitate, we are facilitating the policy development process there, but we take the cue from the policies and allocate and assign internet number resources accordingly. One of the very first activities or services that we did is sort of set up the RIPE database. We maintain that together with you, our community. We do quite a lot of other things as well. We run the K-root name server. We do lots of outreach to our members, to the community, but also to other people out there like regulators and governments and law enforcement and those people. We do implement tools, basically trying to make your lives easier. We do measurements, you heard about that before. We do training as well. The good thing about the RIPE NCC, and one of the important things, is that it's entirely financed by its members. So we are fully autonomous in what we are doing. We do what our members tell us to do. Our operating principles, we are open, transparent, neutral, and impartial. We treat everybody the same according to the policies that we have in place and the procedures reinforce that. We have offices, the main office in Amsterdam, and at the beginning of the year we changed offices, moved, it's all now exciting and new to us. Certainly most of the people work in Amsterdam. And we have a smaller office in Dubai as well. We also have two staff members based in Moscow. And of course, many of us are flying around the world in aircraft as well. But that doesn't count as an official office. So activities, and this is an excerpt basically from the annual report from 2016. So we got lots of new additional members. And you see a curve in a moment there. We see quite a bit of membership growth over the last couple of years. We did loads of V4 allocations still, /22s, little bits, and also a good number of IPv6 allocations. We had people coming to lots of events that we did, so about 3,000 faces that we've seen over the course of the year. In addition to that, we've done over 100 training courses, again, another 2,000 people that we saw, which is very good to see each other so that we can talk to each other and understand your needs and you can tell us what you want from us. More than 2,500 ARCs, that's assisted registry checks, we have completed over 2016. It's basically helping our members to keep tabs on what's in the database and in our registry to make sure that everything is up to date. That's quite useful for us in keeping the registry up to date and correct, but also useful for our members in getting some help in occasionally the nudge to update their stuff. As we've seen the nice picture before, nearly 10,000 Atlas probes out there, 250 nearly RIPE Atlas anchors, loads and loads of RIPE start requests per hour. It's quite a popular service. So we try to do lots of things that are useful to you and to our members. And of course, the whole big annual report is available online. Similar to the financial report, which is in a way part of the activity report. So a couple of numbers from last year, financial numbers. We made a surplus of 325,000 euros. That is after the redistribution of extra money that we had come in basically due to the insane influx of new membership. So for about slightly over 4 million euros we gave back to our members. And I'm happy to say that is a very nice tool for us to adjust for things that we can't control, like membership influx. Our reserves are still at 25 million, so it's slightly more than 1 year turnover, 1 year expenses. Expenses were a little bit lower than expected and budgeted. That's good. Staff numbers just shy of 140 FTEs. Cost per member was down by 8%, which is lovely. That's something that I like to see quite a lot. And again, the full financial report is, of course, available online. That's the graph that I promised you, the steeper getting up and to the right. We see more than 2,000 members, 2,200 members over the last, new members over the last 12 months. We think very, very strongly that is part of the last/aid policy, that lots of people are being sent by their upstreams to us to get their addresses directly from us. So that's what we see there. Our focus of the course for this year, and that is quite similar to last year, is a strong, secure, and accurate registry. That is important, not only for us, not only for you, but also for other people out there, law enforcement and the like, are looking at us, governmental agencies are looking at us for correctness of this, and they're happy if it is correct. Enhancing RIS stability through good governance and accountability. I'll have a couple of words about this in a little while, but basically we have 5 RIRs around the world. It is important that we are seen, that we're not only operating neutrally and impartially and you know, based on bottom-up self-regulation, but also that we are seen to be doing this, that we are seen to be doing this correctly and fairly. And so transparency, good governance is important to us. Efficiency is something that we strive for as well, because it makes things easier for you and easier for us, and also in the end it'll be probably a bit cheaper. So internal processes are being looked at regularly and improved regularly as well, also based on the feedback that we get from you. And of course automation is also a thing where we can deploy it, and I have, again, a couple of slides on that later on. Engaging with members, with the RIPE community, governments, regulators, I said that is something that we continuously for many years now are putting high on to our, into our agenda. And we do regular surveys every 3 years, a big membership, or maybe not so big membership survey, but we get quite a lot of feedback from those things, and from that we derive about like 40, 50, I think Serge mentioned that earlier, action points. We detail them, we report on them, and on the progress on them as well. So, external engagement, like I said, governments, regulators are important, members are, of course, also very important. So we focus on that a bit more, that we try to get into contact with as many of you as possible, and that we inform the others, the non-members, governments where they are not members, in all parts of our service region, also the parts that we don't regularly go to, we try to focus on those bits as well. Additional information gathering, analysis, and strategic positioning for the RIPE NCC in order to be able to do the best we can for you and for the internet at large. Stronger formal relationship with other stakeholder groups. We've been talking to many people for many years, and we are doing things together with them, sort of in terms of especially training and education and the like. And we have now started to document this extremely clearly by just making small MOUs, very high-level MOUs, detailing who we are, who the other party is, and putting that online so that everybody knows about this. So we're not hiding anything. That's basically what I said here. Things that we do together with others to foster more cooperation, coordination for the benefit of all our community. And those other people would be other technical coordination organizations, industry groups, public regulators, law enforcement, academic institutions, and the like. We do also for many, many years things that are generally good for the internet. And I think last year we decided to put this all under one budget line to gather it up so that it's visibly, clearly, and transparently. So the main things that we are doing currently, or starting up currently, there is the Europe Blockstyle Foundation, named after the initial chairman of RIPE. It's a separate entity that and the board for that has been established, and the idea is to give out small awards to people who were very helpful for in growing the RIPE community, basically. We have made a commitment over 10 years, subject to membership approval every year, to help with long-term sustainability of the Internet Engineering Task Force. So it's 100,000 euros per year that we are giving them to keep them running, because they are basically our lifeblood and the basis of what we are doing. We have started the RIPE NCC Community Projects Fund, which is a very nice thing, where we have set up the structure. Now we need to set up a committee, that awarding committee. Basically, the idea here is to fund projects that are seen by that committee, by the community, to be useful, again, for the internet at large or for the RIPE community. Things that we wouldn't want to just give money to because we can. We want to have this nicely funneled and transparently organized there. We also talked about the Seed Alliance initiative with the other southern hemispherical RIRs like LACNIC, AFRINIC, and APNIC. They have this, they have individual programs that are bundled under the Seed initiative that are very much oriented towards developmental work and helping projects that look at sustained and development there. We wanted to do something, and we still, in principle, want to do this, but we looked at this and said, oh, there are many new things that we're doing in the same field, roughly. Let's take a step back from this one, also because I think it'll be a major project there, and revisit that in the future. So, strong, secure, accurate registry, like I said, that's very, very important. Some of the things that we see there is a very nice milestone in the IPv6 world. Remember years ago when we said, oh, IPv6 is coming and we'll run out of IPv4, nobody will do IPv4 anymore, we won't see our members much, we'll give them one large, fairly large IPv6 allocation and that's it, they will never come back, we'll never see them again. Hey, not true. There are the first subsequent IPv6 allocations out there that people said, hey, we need more space. So, good. I mentioned the assisted registry checks, basically keeping in contact with our members, making sure that the data is up to date that we have from them. We are targeting the less active members, those that we haven't seen in a long time. And the overall goal for this is that we would be in contact, touch every member every 3 years, roughly. But with the very strong membership growth that we've seen recently, we are struggling a little bit there, but that's still the general idea there. Resource transfers, with the runout on IPv4 address space, we see more and more resources there. That becomes rather work intensive on our part. There's lots of complex tickets with warranting increased attention, so that we scrutiny, that we look at them and see what really is going on. Sometimes it can be rather complicated. Also in the same field, rather complicated can also mean that something weird is going on that is not quite according to our policies, so we have to check that. There's fraud going on here and there, and we really have to look into that, and we spend quite a lot of work in finding out what is going on and which companies are being founded, being merged, have been bought, or maybe not, and what are those passport copies that we are seeing? Are they real or are they not real? So regularly we see fraud happening, and the board has recently reconfirmed the standing policy that we should go and report confirmed fraud to the Dutch police, and we do that. Efficiency, I mentioned that, yes, efficiency is important, but again, it's a fine balance that we need to strike there between being efficient and being very precise and looking into things as we are seeing them. So we think there is certainly the point to be made for human interaction there, not just automating everything. Okay, accuracy of the registry is important, I said that. We see quite a number of resource transfers now, especially also we have compatible policies with APNIC and ARIN, so we see resources coming in and going out to and from those regions, and clearly the main activity there is with incoming resources to our service region from ARIN. A couple of slides here. No surprise, most of the transfers are about IPv6. Again, the number of addresses being transferred over the last couple of years, and of course you have it all online. Mergers in our service region, and we see a clear rise in mergers there until 2015, and what we've seen is that many people are setting up lots of companies, and they all apply for the last scraps of IPv4, and then at some point they merge. So we've seen that, and we've had a small policy change there, and after that, apparently that policy change has worked. I talked about the policy development process. It's one of the fundamentals of the RIPE community and the RIPE NCC activities. It's important that where we see the need to increase or change or have new policies, that those are properly channeled through the fora. What we see is that from this region there is very, 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 very little. There was very little participation over the course of, I think, 2016. This is. So please have a look at the policy forums, and if there's something that you agree with, that you disagree with, just make yourself known there. That's important also for the legitimacy of the whole process, of course. Right. IPv6 deployment and training. Again, IPv6 deployment in your region is low. We want to help. There are many things that we can do, especially in the training field. We have the RIPE Academy out there, RIPE NCC Academy. That's an online learning tool for you to use and in your own time get a certificate out of it. And so we see that it's fairly popular. Have a look. Also similar for governments, we have had interactions with governments for the last couple of years already, and many of them understand that there is a need to move on to IPv6. They have plans. Governments are heading big things like countries and with lots of complicated and complex infrastructure and layers of government. So we found that it is quite helpful to get ourselves inserted into their planning process relatively early on so that we can give them a helping hand, basically, so that it all goes the right way and is efficient afterwards in sort of batting down the allocations. Policy awareness rising is important, and the procedures, stuff like that. So we are happy to say that we have developed a bit of a training program there for governments, and in general, interaction with governments as part of the community has been successful. Another thing that we have picked up again starting a couple of years ago is academic cooperation. We have the Academic Cooperation Initiative. We've seen a couple of talks early on this morning. It's great to see this happening. Of course, the early RIPE community was made up primarily out of academic players. And as the internet grew madly, we sort of lost track of that a little bit, and we want to get the academic community back in again as part of the community, and we can work together nicely. We've seen some of the results this morning. It's good. It's very encouraging to see that that is being picked up. Talking about efficiency and improvements over the last 6 months, for instance, we've set up a new reverse DNS wizard helping you to set up your reverse DNS that was always error-prone and resulted in lots of tickets and lots of work to help to be done by us. Support calls have quite rapidly gone down over the last couple of months after we implemented this. That's one of the examples where efficiency is good. Also, a more secure LR user account is something that we set up, transferred, migrated more than 35,000 accounts there to single sign-on. Things that we want to do over the next 6 months, we talked about improvement for RPKI, resource PKI, and the validator there. We have something in place. It could be better. It could be more geared towards the real day usage. And we promised that we would implement that over the next couple of months. We'll do that, of course. And also, again, one of the things in helping you to keep tabs on your resources and what you are doing, we want to change the interface, to improve the interface on managing your resources. The RIPE accountability tasks. Yes, we've seen the cessation of the US government's contract basically keeping a virtual thumb on IANA over the last year. It's great. The IANA stewardship has moved on. It's now fully in hand of the communities. In the process of that, there was quite a lot of emphasis on accountability of ICANN, of IANA, and all the various ICANN processes there. And we saw it coming. We saw it coming. And we have prepared for that also attention would be given to the RIRs themselves, which is fine. We have an RIR government governance matrix developed over the last 5 years, probably. Excuse me. What we see now, interesting. What we see now is that attention also goes to the communities that are not formally set up as, for instance, the RIPE NCC Membership Association. That's fairly straightforward and easy to look at how accountability works there. But the RIPE community, it's a group of people coming in from the streets deciding on policy, those things. So we have an accountability task force set up that at this stage looks at documentation, community structures and processes, and tries to figure out if it's all self-explanatory or whether there are holes and whether maybe the community should look at this or that aspect of it and maybe improve on that. So they are working there. And we are looking forward to seeing recommendations or findings to be published to the RIPE community, and then we'll take it from there. And then we had a RIPE meeting recently, and during the RIPE meeting, we had the RIPE NCC general meeting, the formal meeting of the members, where they adopted the financial report for last year, and they discharged the executive board of its duties as they appear in the annual report. And they adopted the charging scheme for next year, 2018, and it'll be again €1,400 for a standard membership, so no change really. Also no change to the board. There were three open board seats, and we had a number of candidates. That was great. And what happened is that Christian, Maria, and Salam... Warm water, thank you. Can I have some tea with that as well? Hot water. Great. So Christian, Maria, and Salam, who were on the board before, apparently have done a good job and were re-elected. Also good to have stability in the board, of course, as well, because they're my bosses, and I know them already, and I know what they want. So, there is a meeting coming up in Dubai. Standard RIPE meeting in a lovely place. It's a bit sandy, maybe. But... the thing that you need to, if you consider coming or following the thing remotely, it starts on Sunday and it goes until Thursday. So it's a one-day offset to the regular RIPE week. If you go to the RIPE meeting and you have sort of a remote interest in ICANN as well, then be aware that the ICANN meeting in Abu Dhabi will happen the week afterwards, so you can get two meetings for the price of one ticket. If you have any questions, I'm here, happy to answer, my colleagues as well, and we'll be here to the end of the day. Thank you.